Good morning and welcome to all of you. We are on the third day of the third national seminar on social work and HIV, which is being organized by the Indira Gandhi National Open University. During the first 2 days, we had discussions on social work and women and on social work and HIV. On the third day, we are extending the facilities of this seminar to our participants across the country in our regional centers and in our study centers. And therefore, a hearty welcome to all the regional directors, the coordinators at the study center, staff in the regional center, as well as our academic counselors and students of bachelor degree in social work and the programs of study on HIV and family education. During this session, we shall be having a formal presentation for about half an hour, and later we will get into interaction with the people both in the studio as well as from participants from across the country. Therefore, without waiting longer, let us get into the first session. The topic of the first session is Women and HIV Social Work Response. Now, this is a very important topic, especially for the social workers when they are in the field practicing what they learn in the classroom. We have with us an expert who has flown in from Mumbai, Professor Vimla Nadkarni. She is an expert on HIV/AIDS as well as on social work, her specialization being psychiatric social work. She will be talking to us about the topic on women and HIV social work response. And now I hand over the mic to Professor Nadkarni. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Thomas, and welcome all of you to this talk of mine, which is on women and HIV social work response. I want to start with a quote by the UN Secretary General Kofi Annan, who has emphasized the importance of educating girls, which is not an option but a necessity. And it is only when girls and young women are able to build the knowledge and confidence and independence, they are able to protect themselves from HIV/AIDS. And he advocates that we must ensure that they have practical options that can protect them from HIV/AIDS. We all know, and the world knows today, that there is increasing feminization of the AIDS epidemic and a growing concern that existing AIDS strategies do not adequately address women's needs. So this paper will cover the global and local estimates and trends, as well as the factors affecting vulnerability of women. I've included girls here to HIV/AIDS, the impact of HIV/AIDS on women and girls, and the social work response. So we begin with the estimates and trends. And we find that there's increasingly larger number of women who are getting infected by HIV all around the world, and including India. 17.3 million women aged 15 years and older are living with HIV, 18% of the global total. And in sub-Saharan Africa, nearly 3 out of 4 young people aged 15 to 24 years are living with HIV, and they are females. That is 74%. Here in this chart, we see how Africa is carrying the burden of HIV/AIDS, but the other countries will soon follow. So the status of women with HIV/AIDS by end 2005, we find that 48% of all adults living with HIV worldwide are women, 59% in sub-Saharan Africa, 30% in Asia, 39% in Thailand, 46% in Cambodia. And even in the United States of America, which is such a developed country, AIDS is a leading cause of death for African American women aged 25 to 34 years. And if you see the trends in India, the AIDS cases according to our age groups, interestingly you will find that in the lower age groups, it's almost a 1-to-1 ratio between male and female, but after the reproductive age, say 30 onwards, for every one male who's infected, for every three men who are infected, you have one woman. We find that the factors are multitudinous, very complex, and as you know, you can see here that they are biological, social, cultural, economic, religious, political. They all interact with each other and they are enhancing the vulnerability of women and young girls to this infection. If we go into the biological factors, there are several aspects to this. One is that women, even with a single exposure, can get infected because of the structure of the cervix. Also, in younger women, the cervix is less mature and therefore much more prone to in the viral attack. And in women, as far as sexually transmitted infections are concerned, we have asymptomatic infections. And because of being asymptomatic, women don't recognize them physically and so they don't go for treatment. So they are even more prone to HIV infection and AIDS. Let us come to the economic, social and cultural factors here. Poverty, marginalization and powerlessness over bodily integrity dominate. And this is found in studies by the International Council of Research in Women and the Population Council. And this is closely linked to our patriarchal system and in South Asia. And we know that in India, the patriarchy dominates and so women have much less power in sexual relationships with their spouses and partners. They are economically dependent on their spouses and sexual partners. And they are discouraged to learn about their bodies and sex in general. I mean, there's a culture of silence about sex and sexuality issues. And we all know that even in our own families, I mean, how many of our parents have really taught us, you know, about the sex, about the reproductive system, you know, or even girls having menstruation, they are not prepared for all these physiological changes in themselves. So the interplay of household poverty, migration is a very important factor, and the demand, increasing demand of sexual services of young girls is increasing the spread of this epidemic. And women and girls are being forced to use sex as a commodity in exchange for, you know, economic benefits, goods, services, money, accommodation and other basic amenities. And we also know about the tremendous and terrible violence against women, which earlier has been undercover, it has been, you know, just swept under the carpet. And interestingly, the most prevalent forms of violence against women are perpetrated within the domestic sector, within the family, by their own intimate partners, by their own husbands and sexual partners. And studies show in Bangladesh, Ethiopia, Peru, Samoa, Thailand and the United Republic of Tanzania, that 40 to 60% of women surveyed said that they have experienced sexual abuse. And studies in South Africa and Tanzania show that women who have been subjected to violence are up to 3 times more likely to be HIV infected than women who have not experienced violence. And in India, there are studies being conducted, and we are waiting for the results. It's from Johns Hopkins, Dr. Michael Koenig. He is undertaking surveys, especially in the northern belt in India, and we trying to see the relationship between domestic violence and HIV. And there is fear that disclosure will lead to violence. So even if women are infected, they are afraid to share about that infection. There is a study here at a clinic in Zambia. Some 60% of women eligible for free antiretroviral treatment opted out of treatment, partly because they feared violence and abandonment if they were to disclose their HIV status to their partners. There is a case of Jane from Uganda who said that she secretly tested for HIV in 1999 when she found out that her husband had AIDS. She explained, "I was scared to tell him that I had tested HIV positive. He used to say of the woman who gives him AIDS, I will chop off her feet. I have never told him." So you can imagine what women are facing all over the world, especially in our developing countries and India. In India, women do face a lot of violence. They are not able to negotiate condom use, even if they know that their men are going for extramarital contacts with sex workers or with multiple partners. That's because they are so powerless in our country. And who is saying this? You know Peter Piot? He is heading the UNAIDS organization in Geneva, and he says that males are driving the epidemic. I'm sure the men will not be happy to hear this. But what does he say? That too little has been done on the ground to encourage men and boys to embrace gender equal norms and behaviors. Because let's face it also, this epidemic is driven by male behavior. We are increasingly seeing globally wars, disasters, ecological disasters, natural disasters, man-made disasters, and displacement of populations both in the urban and rural areas. In May 2005, in Zimbabwe, 700,000 people lost their homes in operation which to cleanse the filth. Of course, it is Murambatsvina. I hope you can repeat that word with me. A campaign of forcible evictions and demolitions in urban areas throughout the country. And this displacement had disrupted access to health, to life-saving therapies for individuals with HIV and TB, and it has encouraged the emergence of multi-drug resistant strains and conditions. So all these factors are spurring the epidemic. We also have conflict, which is increasing the spread of HIV. Sexual abuse of women and girls in conflict situations is rampant. The HIV is being used to infect populations for ethnic cleansing. And when the economy and social infrastructure are destroyed and male heads of households are missing, women carry a disproportionate burden as single parent heads of families, and they are exploited and forced into prostitution to enable them to run their families. We all know that women and girls have less access to education, whether you look at it globally or in India, which means 62 million girls continue to be denied the chance to attend primary school among 117 million children. In sub-Saharan Africa, only 60% of boys and 50% of girls are in school. In South and West Asia, 20% fewer girls than boys are enrolled in secondary school. And in India, only 2 out of 5 women can read or write, and about 40% girls under 14 do not go to school. According to the 2001 census, which has provided some provisional statistics, only 54.16% women compared to 75.85% men are literate in the age group 7 and over. So education goes with access to information and knowledge, knowledge of HIV information among young people in 18 countries indicate that less than 50% have comprehensive knowledge about HIV, and in all but 3 countries in recent surveys, young women know significantly less about HIV than do young men. And we all know from the National Family Health data, the survey, that while women know what is AIDS or AIDS, but they are not able to indicate specifically what are the routes of transmission. They may know one or two routes of transmission, not all the routes of transmission. So the detailed information, you know, which will help them to look at behaviors, change behaviors, is not available to them, especially in the remote, rural, and in the poverty groups. Developmental factors like health, the public health system is not adequately catering in any case to the poor. The poor typically benefit less from health services than the rich, except where special efforts are made to reach the poorer citizens. Among key health services, the gap in the use between rich and poor is greatest for modern contraception and skilled delivery assistance. And the wealthiest women are four to five times more likely than the poorest women to use these services. And this is seen in the charts in terms of both vaccine coverage and the use of antenatal care services. We have inequalities in the preventing mother-to-child program. And in 2005, only 9% of pregnant women in low and middle income countries were offered services to prevent transmission of HIV to their newborns. Though in 2006, figures show whatever data is available that there is not much difference in women's access. Definitely, women have less access in India. If there is a preference to spend on men and women, men are preferred. Money is spent on men rather than women, and so women do have barriers. We have issues of malnutrition, very high levels of malnutrition in our country. I mean, you have heavy medication for women and children, and not adequate nutrition, so there are high levels of toxicity. There is also lack of participation in policy and programs, lack of involvement of women in policies and programs. Women's organizations have not been very, you know, active in responding to HIV/AIDS, because I spoke to a woman activist, and she said that, look, there is so much money pouring into HIV/AIDS that, you know, we don't want to jump onto that bandwagon, and we are worried that if we work in this area, the other areas will get, it will divert us, our attention from others. But we do have women's organizations coming forward to work on sexual and reproductive health issues. Fortunately, there are networks of women, positive women in India, though of course we all know that disclosure of their status does lead to stigma and discrimination. So not many positive women are ready to come out and declare themselves and give their testimonies. The state response to HIV/AIDS in terms of gender mainstreaming has also been a little cool. There's not adequate integration of gender equity issues in all the policies and programs. Vulnerable women among the group of women, like sex workers, adolescents, married women, are not being addressed adequately. And there's continuous shift in the leadership in NACO, which is also causing problems in the implementation of programs. For women in prostitution, there's multiple disadvantages. They're already a stigmatized group. There's terrible harassment by police and criminals. There's abuse, both physical and sexual abuse, and forced HIV testing accompanied by quarantine. And sex workers do suffer from psychological stress, trauma, injuries, infections. If we go to the impact of HIV/AIDS on women, I wanted to start with the story of Urmila, who was a trained social worker married to an engineer. And when she was 5 months pregnant, she was tested positive. It was a tremendous trauma for the family, but husband and wife decided to have the child and look after it. Unfortunately, the husband died, and she had to look after the child alone. She did not get support from her in-laws. They took away her property, her share in the property, and she shifted to her parents, who fortunately have been supporting her, and she's now working with the international organization. She has got herself, you know, trained, educated, and empowered. So we need more women like her to come forward, but the impact is so terrible on our women. There's complete deprivation of basic rights, discrimination, aspersions on their sexual life. They are blamed for husband's death and illness. They are deprived of all entitlements, even children. Because of them, children are denied basic immunity. They have to suffer the guilt of having passed on the infection to children. And studies among people living with HIV in India, Indonesia, Philippines, and Thailand have found that women were significantly more likely than men to suffer discrimination, harassment, physical abuse, etc., etc. But they are also the beasts of burden. They carry the burden of not only the infection, but as caregivers, they have to continue household tasks. As the husband dies, they have to look for employment, and they are facing a lot of stresses. So women need a lot of support at all stages, before the illness, during the illness, after the illness. So what kind of support can we provide? One is that we have to remove gender-based barriers through supporting HIV disclosure. Maybe counseling, care and support services. We need to advocate for antiretroviral therapy, which of course depends a lot on legal rights and freedoms. Support changes in cultural behavior so that cultural norms support women in coming forth, and also enable the healthcare system to provide adequate services for women. We need to lobby with the government to make testing free and invest in ARTs for women, and also post-exposure prophylaxis for women and girls who are raped and who are forced into sex by elder men and others who are exposed to HIV infection. We need to advocate and defend right to equitable treatment of all people, irrespective of culture, belief, gender, age, sexual orientation, race, caste, etc., etc. And advocate that women receive all entitlements, whether it's land, property, health, education, food, and social security, care, and support. We also need to engage in the fight against poverty as a key element in prevention of HIV infection. We cannot work in the field of HIV/AIDS without seeing it in the context of developmental issues and human rights. We need to work actively with women's groups so that they uphold their rightful place as principal partners in addressing the pandemic and as active participants in decision making and policy implementation at all levels. We need to advocate for public and social health policies that effectively provide a continuum of care that promotes and improves quality of life for everyone affected and infected by HIV/AIDS, and constantly battle the stigmatization and resultant discrimination that attaches to HIV/AIDS, no matter what its source and no matter what its target. We need to uphold and protect sexual and reproductive health rights. We need to offer premarital counseling and testing. We need to work with women towards social and economic empowerment. And you have heard today about Yunus from Muhammad Yunus from Bangladesh. He has received the Nobel Peace Prize because he's the one who initiated microfinance for women, and India has caught up very fast on formation of self-help groups. But self-help groups not only for microfinance or savings, but we need to work with self-help groups to empower them to work on these issues. we also need to track the implementation of the Millennium Development Goals and Human Rights Convention. So we need to work with the government, with non-government organizations, with community-based organizations, and bring women and girls closer to services and create new resources where required, not only in our country, but also create international pressure to see that women's rights are protected. And of course, as social workers, we are also educators besides practitioners. We need to innovate comprehensive, practical and theoretical HIV/AIDS education in the context of human development within the curricula, acknowledge and work through our own fears and prejudices. We need to work with ourselves, with our own attitudes, to foster respect for people living with HIV/AIDS, to help build partnerships, to undertake evidence-based practice, ensure social work perspective on prevention, intervention, care, treatment, support and health promotion, and involve people living with AIDS not as a tokenism, but in a sincere effort that they become our field level researchers. They are helping us to design research programs, participating in data collection, in analysis, and they also get the recognition for this in our papers, in publications, etc. And they also realize the importance of research for practice. And I think we all need to resolve to work together to prevent the spread of HIV among women and young girls and protect them and provide them a continuum of care and support. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Nadkarni. You did a very wonderful presentation on the social work response to women who are infected or affected by HIV. Your presentation was very positive, very encouraging, very informative. A lot of information and knowledge you have shared with our participants. In fact, you have given a lot of suggestions as to how the policymakers, people involved in curriculum development, teachers, trainers, NGOs, and particularly social workers in various sectors, how they could play positive roles in reaching out to people infected and affected by the virus. We will now throw open our discussion for interaction with participants both in the studio as well as at the regional centers, and as and when we get the calls from regional centers, we will give the importance and the first opportunity. In the meantime, I also welcome interventions by the participants present here in the studio. Now, as we go on, since Professor Nadkarni was already working and involved with many NGOs and organizations at the national level and international level, I have a direct question to you about how, what is your kind of assessment about the kind of awareness, the kind of education program, the kind of intervention by the government organizations. To what extent are they meaningful? To what extent have we succeeded? Are we all right with what is happening, or there is much needs to be done? Where do we stand now?
I think, like I mentioned earlier, that the commitment to HIV/AIDS at the national level has been a slow process. If you take the history of, you know, how the government program started in 1989, they started with, you know, more on using a fearful approach. There was focus on AIDS education, and you know, the kind of posters that were put up were not very conducive for a positive understanding of this whole epidemic. But over time, we have seen the national organization being much more active The national organization is supposed to play the role of the facilitator. It has created, earlier it used to be AIDS cells, and then it created the AIDS control organizations at the state level. So there has been decentralization of the process at the state level. But we find that there are differences in the state responses. Like some states are more active and some states are not very active. And the state is depending a lot on the national policy and the national guidelines for implementation. Because of international pressures and also international studies, especially World Bank studies, the focus has been on the so-called high-risk groups. So the high-risk groups have been those that are, you know, very convenient, where HIV infection rates have been very high or perceived to be very high, like the sex workers, and then we've had the truck drivers. You know, even the slum population has been, you know, targeted as high-risk groups. Now, this, in a way, has diverted attention or, you know, to not to recognizing that HIV is now in the general population. So we are actually in the third and fourth stage of the epidemic, where we are seeing more and more HIV infections in the general population, and that is where we need to now focus our response. I understand that in the National AIDS Control Program 3, there is going to be some focus on women and gender issues, but I mean, if you read the program, there doesn't seem to be adequate attention paid to very specific programming in those areas. The National AIDS policy is still not a policy. It is still in the making. It is still a draft. It has not still been accepted as a policy, though it is quite well developed, and you know, but it has not come out as a policy. So there are gaps in the national response, in the state response, and I think that because there's so much money being poured into HIV/AIDS, you know, and so many people are trying to create organizations, whether they are non-government organizations or community-based organizations, not all of them are adequately oriented to these issues. So I feel that when at the field level, if any organization is coming forward to HIV, the selection for funding should be very strict. Also, there is need for mainstreaming of HIV/AIDS into the development programs and human rights programs. Now, we cannot just afford to have a CBO only working on HIV/AIDS. I think everywhere HIV/AIDS, sexual and reproductive health should be part of our overall, it should be a comprehensive package deal that we need to work on.
We have a question here for Charles Leon.
I'm for Charles Leon, faculty in Social Work Department, Loyola College of Social Sciences, Trivandrum. Thank you very much for the informative session. You have clearly analyzed the factors leading and how the women are affected and the social work response. Now, I would like to add or to get your response that many religious groups, they also experiment different models. And how do you respond to that? Because there are many agencies financing such programs. Without getting any such finance, there are many religious groups. They play a vital role in creating awareness related to HIV/AIDS. And how do we document those models which are experimented already in our country, and do we include those models in our social work education, especially of creating awareness? Because there are many formal groups we have, and the government is supporting those formal groups, but there are many informal groups which are not supported, but they are really creating a lot of impact in the people, especially of the rural areas. So, do we have any such documentation, and how do we respond to that, especially of when you said the policy implications, policy formulations, a major role are played. I think you have referred many secondary data, but primary these models can be those which are experimented in many of our states and also many by many religious groups. So those things can be added, and how do you respond to that? Thank you.
Can I respond to that?
Yeah, there has been documentation of some very important experiments which have been successful, and not only have they received recognition abroad. I mean, they have first received recognition abroad and then in India, like the Sonagachi project. I mean, that's a very well-known project where sex workers or women in prostitution have been mobilized. They have formed their own organization and they are now dealing with their own issues. They are, working at a policy level. They are creating pressure on governments. They are watchdogs. So they are playing a very important role. And we have a similar experiment in Maharashtra, which is called Sangram, which is run in fact by a social worker, our own graduate, and she has really struggled to bring up this organization, and they have to constantly campaign, resist the state forces, you know, for independence of women, and the sex work, you know, the women in prostitution want to rehabilitate themselves. They don't want outsiders to come in and, you know, deal with the issues. They want to deal with the issues themselves. And constantly, you know, the organization is fighting the state forces like police and the politicians, etc. So that also has been documented. We have research organizations like the Horizons Project, the Population Council, the Ford Foundation, that have, through research, documented programs. Even for example, in South India, in Chennai, we have Suniti Solomon's YRG Care Foundation. Their experiments have been documented for upscaling. They have this public-private partnership, and they have sort of experimented with private hospitals in Chennai and providing care and support and a continuum of, so that has been documented. So the point that you're making is extremely important, and we definitely have documentation. There's a book also brought out by Radhika Ramasubban where she's looked at different innovations in the field of HIV/AIDS, and I think we need to bring these documents into our curriculum to help analyze the processes, the tools, the techniques, the strategies, the practices, and so that our students learn from these processes. As far as faith-based organizations are concerned, of course they are very important. They play a very major role in our country and many countries, and their innovations. I think the community health association, no, sorry, the Christian Health Association of India has sort of been quite sensitive and tried to have programs, and the Ramakrishna Mission in West Bengal has been working very closely on HIV/AIDS issues. Faith-based organizations also have an important role. It's very important because they are the ones dealing with people at the grassroots, and people listen to them. So if they are sensitized, and if they become our partners, they would make a lot of difference to people. So as social work colleges, we need to discuss this issue much more, because there's always this concern, because we know today how religion is being mishandled. You know, it's being misused, it's being used for exploitation. So we need to be quite aware of how faith-based organizations will be.
I think there's one question from Dr. Sivakumar. Try to be brief.
I am Dr. D. Sivakumar, Head of Department of Social Work, University of Kerala, at the University Institute of Technology, Trivandrum. I wish to know that the social work methods like social group work practice and the life history analysis and studies on transdisciplinary studies, multidisciplinary studies, etc., on the role of social work interventions in the HIV/AIDS sector. Kindly elaborate.
Yeah.
I think we need to do more research in this area. There is not adequate research. We are not, as social workers, doing adequate research. We need to do much more, maybe through our PhD students. We social workers always feel we are so busy, we are practicing or we are teaching, we don't have enough time. But what I believe is that we should be doing intervention research, action research, where any program that we take, there should be research built into that program so that we can have baseline data, we do the intervention, we document the processes, and we are able to evaluate our impact. What is happening today is we are, as social workers, we are not able to demonstrate the specific impact we are making, whether it is counseling, whether it is, you know, mobilizing people, whether it is mobilizing women's groups, whether it is empowerment. We are not able to demonstrate our impact, and we definitely need research. And I think the point that you brought out is interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary, because that would really strengthen the quality of research. That is very important. But I think we, as social work students, have a very major role to play in your master's thesis, if you're doing bachelor level projects, PhD projects. You know, we can have a research program, you know, for undertaking research. You mentioned, may
we have received a fax from Simla regional director there, saying that the students are watching the program along with academic counselors, both in the study center and the regional center, and they have asked for a question because they are not able to get on to us through the telephone. So it's a fax which they have sent. Kindly provide some data on Himachal Pradesh also, which has a history of truck drivers coming in contact with possible HIV infected sex workers. You have any such information which you may like to share at this juncture?
Unfortunately, I cannot give you any figures. There are studies, lot of studies done on truck drivers, you know, where we find that they have become a bridge population, transmitting infection to their own families. Now, the danger here is that truck drivers have been targeted so much that I remember when I visited one of the places in the north where they were having a very successful program with truck drivers unions, we found that the truck drivers did not want to respond adequately because they were being stigmatized, and their families, their men, were not getting women in marriage, you know. So while we do have many studies that have been done on these populations, we need to be a little careful. There have been studies done in the north, and we need to be a little careful that we don't look only at truck drivers as a group, but we need to look at wider populations.
Well, friends, we are coming to the close of this first session. We'll have the second session just after 15 minutes of break, in which we shall be talking about social work and women. Now I wish to thank Professor Vimala Nadkarni for giving us a wonderful presentation with a lot of information and knowledge on women and HIV, along with lots of suggestions for social workers. Definitely we should be able to put into practice some of those suggestions, and we must all make some effort that we are able to reach out to our students in the classrooms, especially with students of social work and students who have taken up programs of study on HIV AIDS and family life education. I thank all the audience present here in the studio as well as across the country, and for those people who have made their interventions. Thank you, one and all.
Can I show one slide, or is it ending?